I want to call your attention to Psalm 103. I need to read the psalm, then I'll go to the focal verses for today's message. Psalm 103. You should be able to find it with great ease in your pew Bible. Just turn to Psalms 103. I need to read the whole psalm. I want you to bring your Bibles with you so you can mark off in your Bibles so you can see it for yourself. Y'all got it? Psalm 103. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgiveth all thy iniquities, who healeth all thy diseases, who redeemeth thy life from destruction, who crowneth thee with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfieth thy mouth with good things, so that thy youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord executeth righteousness and judgment for all that are oppressed. He made known his ways unto Moses, his acts to the children of Israel. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and plenteous in mercy. He will not always chide, neither will he keep his anger forever. He hath not dealt with us after our sins, nor rewarded us according to our iniquities. For as the heaven is high above the earth, so great is his mercy toward them that fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far hath he removed our transgressions from us. Like a father pitieth his children, so the Lord pitieth them that fear him. When he knoweth our frame, he remembereth that we are dust. As for man, his days are as grass, as the flower of the field, and so he flourishes. For the wind passeth over it, and it is gone, and the place thereof shall be. Know it no more. For the mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting upon them that fear him, and his righteousness unto children's children, to such as keep his covenant, and to those that remember his commandments to do them. The Lord hath prepared his throne in the heavens, and his kingdom ruleth over all. Bless the Lord, all ye, his angels that excel in strength and do his commandments, hearkening unto the voice of his word. Bless ye the Lord, all ye, his hosts, ye ministers of his that do his pleasure. Bless the Lord, all his works in all places of his dominion. Bless the Lord, O my soul. That's Psalm 103. I want to lift up in particular verses 17 and 18, where it reads, but the mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting upon them that fear him, and his righteousness unto children's children, to such as keep his covenant, and to those that remember his commandments to do them. In verse 17 and other verses where you see the word fear, is the word is reverence. 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 Upon them that revere him, that are in awe of God. I'm using it as a subject today, securing our children's future. God, for your glory, use me, I ask and pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Securing our children's future. This message was given to me some weeks ago as far as the text that the Lord wanted me to share on this day. And from the time the Lord gave me this until yesterday, He's allowed me to see some things that will help us understand what God is saying to us today. I don't know about you, but you ought to have been disturbed when the young brother from Morehouse College was killed. Here's a brother trying to do something. Okay? Making his contribution to his community, wanting to serve as a mentor to somebody else. And someone takes his life just a couple blocks from his home. That was distressing to me. And it should have distressed you, as challenging as it is for us as African Americans to get into college. Those who are in college to have their lives taken away from them all to be troubled. It bothered me as I read the story and then to find out that Sylvia is friends with, I think it's this person's aunt, or knows this person's aunt. It's all of a sudden it hits home as to people that we may know. Then I was looking at the news, and if you saw on the news, the lady that went to the convenience store, the gas station, and she left the car running for a second to run inside the store, and when she comes out, two young men stealing her car, and she needed her car for work, and she tries to save her car, if you will, so no one would take it. She ends up being dragged at least, I would imagine, at least 20 feet before letting go. And it bothered me that we're looking at our young people taking into their own hands matters that they ought not be involved in at all. I look around and see, this other day I saw a young person that I've seen grow up as a child, and he has to be about 25 years of age now, and still walking around with his pants just below his butt. And he's like, my God, you know, aren't you gonna grow up, you know? You need to tell me that this is how you're gonna be, because at the age of 25, you want to be making some money in life, and there's no way in the world he can have a decent job looking the way that he looked. And I was kind of discouraged as I saw these things. Just think about trying to present a message today that I saw. But then, as I looked at this man, I thank God for giving me hope. A few weeks ago, sitting out at Jenkins Cornell University, where our nephew, Robert Johnson, graduated. An African American, he graduated from an Ivy League school. Very prestigious. And looking at the audience, 6,000 college students graduated. 6,000. Let me know that there is something with our young people, and I'll let people be those who will do what is right. And I was just honored and blessed that my nephew graduated with a job in labor relations and already has a job working for the Walt Disney Corporation in Florida. So I found joy there. I found joy. This past week I had the privilege of being a part of our Baptist General State Convention. And on Tuesday, there was a young man, and his name is Barnes, or it's Cassie Barnes, the fourth. And he was playing the keyboard, and I noticed that this guy is really, really gifted and blessed by God. He reminded me of Elder Eric Thomas when he was playing with Beth at the age of 18. This young man is about the same age. And I spoke to him afterward and I said, man, you are really, really talented. But I want you to know that you have an anointing in your life. You don't understand it all, but you know, you're talented, but there is anointing that's on your life that only God is doing. That was on Tuesday. On Thursday, the president gave his address as part of the ministry. The dance team from the Church of Pastors was the dance team performed. And as they were performing to the sound of pre-recorded music on the CD, while they were dancing, the CD went out. And this young man, Mr. Barnes, got to the piano so fast, was in the right key of the CD song, that the children who were dancing did not miss a beat. I mean, it was like just wow. I was just amazed at what I saw. And afterward, I had to tell them, I said, I talked to you Tuesday, you didn't remember, I said, you got an anointing in your life. And I said, what happened tonight is what I'm talking about, that anointing in your life. See, somebody's talented can be just sitting down. But because of God in his life, he got up at the right time and continued playing as if the music wasn't from the keyboard all the while. It was just a beautiful sight. And I told his father, I said, Pastor Barnes, I said, man, your son is anointed. And he said to me, I want you, you know, I appreciate that, because I'm going to tell him again, because I told him, but when other people say it, it just does his heart good. And so I was feeling good, talking about the craziness that people had done. I started feeling good about what people are doing, how God is using people. Then on yesterday, that's not what I had, I was in ordination council meeting all day. Yesterday, I stopped by church before the flea market ended. I'm standing outside, and two young men come up. Instead of just walking by, they said hello to me. They started talking, and they wanted to know what's going on. I explained to them the ministry of the church that was going on. They did not live in the community, but they were walking to get their hair cut. And so we talked. And it was a good conversation, intelligent young men, a good conversation. One is in college and one's getting to go to high school. It was so refreshing to hear young men talk, and young men look presentable. And he said, you know, still got some food in there? I said, yeah, the food was right in the corner there. I said, you're hungry? He said, yeah. He said, we're going to get something, we're going to get our hair cut. I said, are you hungry? He said, yeah. What you want? Because at this point, the Lord was saying, bless these young men. Bless them. And so I blessed them. So they have something to eat. Because I saw something in them that was revealed in them just in a conversation. And I started feeling better. I felt better. I felt relieved. And so it helps tie in the sermon. Whereas I'm asking you to understand that our children's future can be secured when we understand God's word for us. We got to secure our children's future. Because if you look around, our young people are challenged today. Challenged with drugs, challenged with teenage pressure, challenged with unemployment, challenged with people who are just doing wrong, challenged with some parents who are not giving them any credit for what it is that they have done. Our young people are challenged, academically challenged, economically challenged, living in a society where people are taking one another's lives. They are challenged, and they need to know that they can make it. I have spoken to young kids who have said they didn't expect to live past the age of 25. And my goodness, that's mind-boggling, because we need things that got so bad that young people don't expect to live a long time. How can we secure our children's future? And that's what the Lord was laying on my heart. How can we make sure that our children are going to make it? And God said, it's in my word. So have you turn to Psalm 103, verses 17 and 18. But the mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting upon them that fear him, and his righteousness unto children's children, to such as keep this covenant, and to those that remember his commandments to do them. Our children's future will be secured when men and women of God understand the responsibility that we have in nurturing our children. Are we here to train up a child in the way he should go? And when he gets old, he will not depart from. Yes, we know that verse. But this verse is saying something that speaks to all of us. It says that the Lord's mercies are from everlasting to everlasting. Meaning God's been good to us. God has been with us every step of the way. But this everlasting to everlasting mercy that we receive is received when you fear God, when you are in awe of God, when you reverence God, when you recognize who God is. And what has happened, we've gotten so sophisticated that we live our lives as if we don't need God. The reality is, I speak for myself, I need thee. Oh, I need thee. Every day I need thee. And when we are in awe of God, when we recognize that God is, you didn't wake yourself up this morning, don't you realize that? The activity of your lips, don't you realize that it's God who's blessing you? The eyes that you see, the ears that you hear, you ought to be in awe of God. You ought to just think about how God blesses you, that you drove here today. What have you done for me lately? It's almost an attitude that people have. God blessed you. You get a haircut. Go to the beauty shop to buy some clothes. God has blessed you to put food on your table, put food in your refrigerator, and food in your freezer. God has blessed you so that you can have leftovers to eat whenever you want. You ought to just be in awe of God and thank God, because there are people who are hungry every day. We throw more food away, and there are people who are hungry, and we aren't doing anything about it. You ought to be in awe of God that He thinks enough of you to provide for you everything that you need. You ought to be in awe of God to live 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90 years. And there are young people saying they don't expect to live past 25. You ought to be in awe of God. Well, every day that God gives you, you ought to wake up telling God thank you. Every time you lay down at night, you ought to take the time to tell God thank you. As you make it through the day, to take the time to say, Lord, thank you. You ought to be in awe of God. Something ought to just breathe in your spirit. Last night. I don't know how which one of y'all lost? Could have bought some groceries. Could have put some gas in your car. Could have bought some more clothes. But when that person dies, who has all that money now, it ain't going with them. God's mercy is from everlasting to everlasting to those that fear Him. And I'm suggesting that as adults, that we live our lives in the awe of God, some person will look at us and see something in us that we will recognize that there's nobody but God. And that's how we look at securing our children's future. We have to be in awe of God. We have to walk like God. Hallelujah. Walk like God lives in us. Talk like God lives in us. Act like God lives in us. Present ourselves like God lives in us. Instead of trying to do anything and everything, trying to impress somebody else, why not take the time to let God know that you're pleased with how God has smiled upon you, and live your life and say the things and do the things that will honor God, that will give God glory and bless God. I'm just talking about securing our children's future. But there's something else. When you fear Him, the righteousness of God will just go on and on and on to your children's children. But this is why or how it happens, is when you keep His covenant and when you do His commandments. Keep His covenant. Yeah, God said, I'm with you always, even to the end of the world. God incarnate, God in the flesh, God with us. His covenant is that I'll be there for you. And we have to live our lives to recognize that God's word says that He'll be there for us. And then His word says that these blessings come when we do His commandments. If you want to be a blessing to the children and the future being secure, the burden of proof, if you will, is on us. It's on us to be in all God. It's for us to understand that God has covenant with us. It's for us to be obeying the commandments of God. Are y'all with me? Now this is very, very simple to understand. What does God's word say? The fruit of the Spirit. Two passages of scripture I want to share with you. Galatians 5, 22, 26. And Matthew 25, 22 through 26. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Let us not be desirous of vainglory, provoking one another, envying one another. That's a word that's given to us so that we can secure our children's future. The commandments of God. Yeah. Look at God's word. He gives a reward when you feed the hungry, clothe the naked, visit those who are sick. Help those who have been in prison, physically and mentally. Do these things. In other words, be a blessing to somebody else. And then the Lord will say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Pastor Jenkins, as I listen to you, how can I I say that this message is real. As far as securing our children's future, I tell you, I stand here today having been blessed by my parents who took the time to raise me in the church. Yes, they were there, but it was just not my parents alone. There were folk in the church who watched me grow and who watched me make mistakes, who did not mind correcting me. I was raised in an atmosphere because church folk knew that they had a responsibility in making sure that the children of the church would be able to make it. You know I'm telling the truth because I look at you and I know that it was more than mommy and daddy that helped you get to the point where you are. There were people in the church who said to you, you don't be running in the church. Who said to you, you don't be doing this or that in the church. But at the same time teaching us that the church was a sacred place where we would honor God. And we told them that they told us that if you're going to shout, you got to shout for the Lord. And if you want to make a noise, you got to make a joyful noise unto the Lord. They had a way of disciplining, but at the same time teaching us as to how we can honor God. And one thing they did, yeah, my generation said, we stayed in church all day, morning Sunday school all day, morning service all day, afternoon service, yeah, BYPU and the evening service. We were there all day long, but guess what? We turned out all right. There was something about the church that helped us on our journey. And not only that, besides mom and daddy, there was Aunt Susie and Aunt Jill and Brother Kenneth and Brother Bob who guided us along the way. And every now and then, they would shake our hands and put some money in our hands and say, the Lord wants to bless you. And they encouraged me by saying, we need you to do this or to do that. You ought to sing in the choir. You ought to be an usher. You ought to come to Sunday school. And I found out that the more this hallelujah spoke to my spirit, the more God was moving in my life. And I stand here today to let you know somebody prayed for me. Because when I was a little boy, they saw something in me and lived a life whereby I could see God in them. I'm trying to help somebody today. We have children who are lost. We have children who need to know that God is the way. We have children who need a hug and need a smile and a word of encouragement. I'm glad today that I'm able to say that I thank God for the church, because it was in the church that I was reminded of the love that God has for me. It was in the church that was brought to remembrance about the life of Jesus and how he died for my sins. I'm glad today that I was in the church. I'm glad today that I know something about Jesus. I don't know it all, but I know something about Jesus. He'll soothe your troubled spirit. He'll dry tears from your eyes. I'm glad today that somebody saw
sick. He had a doctor 24 hours a day, 7 days a week at your bedside. You may not have seen him, but you felt the healing power of God. Is there anybody here that's felt the presence of God in your life? Is there anybody here?
And I am the one to save.